Local heroes go their own way. Local heroes want to change their world. Local heroes need global insights.
We are there for you with more news and information, comprehensive background, and relevant analysis.
All the news, all the time, up to the minute. Plus, all the latest trends in business, culture, and sports. DW, Global Insights, broadcast from Germany. With continuous coverage of key stories from Europe and the world, mixed with a wide range of programs.
DW has been the trusted source of news and information for more than 60 years.
And DW also plays a prominent role in the digital age, with free, uncensored information, with a forward-looking multimedia strategy. Be well informed at any time on the move with the new DW News app. Live, interactive, personalized, and always in dialogue with users. The diverse palette of DW services, making an important contribution to the strengthening of international relations in a digital world.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome your host, Terry Martin.
Thank you. Good morning and welcome to this final session of the third and final day of the of DW's Global Media Forum 2015, focusing on media and foreign policy in the digital age. My name is Terry Martin. I'm an anchor at DW News. I hope you all have slept well, and you may not have noticed it, but the weather, I'm told, is improving. I'm told there's a 10% chance of rain today in Bonn, and there's a good chance that we will see some sunshine this afternoon. So I'm very happy to announce that. Before we get started, I'm just going to give you a quick overview of what's coming up today so you have that in your mind. First, we have our plenary session right here, taking us through to 11 o'clock. Then we have a half-hour coffee break, a final networking opportunity there, if you will. At 11:30, we have our last set of workshops. There are six workshops, I believe, to choose from. And at 1 p.m., we reassemble here for a keynote address and Q&A with Dr. Scylla Elworthy. Looking very forward to that. We wrap it all up with a closing address by DW's Director General, Peter Limborg. But first things first, our plenary session this morning is on a very serious subject. It's something that unfortunately is sure to keep we folks in the media and, of course, policymakers very busy for the years to come. We're talking about resource wars and their implications for foreign and security policy. The session will be moderated by a dear friend and colleague of mine who will be familiar to anyone who has watched the news on DW in recent years. Ladies and gentlemen, please give a warm welcome to DW News anchor Amrita Cheema.
Thank you very much, Terry, and a very warm welcome to all of you from me as well. Now, this is a very special GMF for us, because those of you who were here on Monday would see that we launched our new 24-hour English channel. Now, four of our anchors are presenting this week, and four of us were invited to come here to share this very special moment for us. We are very emotional about this. We have great ambitions to bring you a wonderful show. And Terry Martin is one of my colleagues who's a news anchor. I'm a news anchor, and you saw Brian Thomas yesterday. He is also part of our lineup. Now, before I start the session, let me just give you a couple of what they call housekeeping rules. I would request you to keep your phones on silent, but do use your phones, because I would like you to be involved in sharing your comments through Twitter. We have Yakov here, who's monitoring all that you're saying, and we'll invite him to kind of share some of your comments with us during our panel discussion. Let me give you a quick overview as to how I plan to go about. I'll be introducing my panelists, after which we'll have a discussion for, say, about 50 minutes. And then I would like to throw ask you to contribute to the panel, to be part of the conversation. So listen carefully. I would like to have your comments. I would like to have your questions. And we'll have about half an hour for that. And then perhaps we'll have a final look at what Twitter comments are coming in. Having said that, let me now welcome you to our plenary, which is on resource wars, implications for foreign and security policy. Now, many people would argue that resource wars are nothing new. For centuries, competing claims between communities, between countries, and between ethnic groups have been the foundation of much conflict and much tension. But today, we are facing a somewhat unprecedented situation. Our population is increasing. By 2050, 9 billion people will live on this planet. At the same time, our resources are depleting rapidly. Climate change is adding stress to the natural resources that we have in the country. All of this, of course, means that the potential for conflict is much greater. Risk to security is much higher. Now, this poses a huge challenge for foreign policy because resource wars have become a crucial element in our foreign policy discussions today. When you look at contemporary conflicts, be it the annexation of Crimea by Russia, be it an argument over the Spratly Islands of the South China Sea, quite often it is really a fight for resources. So how does one balance national interest with international responsibility? To discuss this, we have a wonderful panel for you, and may I invite them to please come and take their place here on the dais. So if you sit, Mr. Nooke. Now, it's my great pleasure to introduce the panel to you, and I'm going to do it in alphabetical order. Jan Friedrich Kallmorgen is a partner with Interel, a Brussels-based public affairs consultancy. He is a founder of BKP, a government relations company in Berlin. Previously, he worked for Goldman Sachs and also with the German Council on Foreign Relations. And he's also the co-founder of something called the Atlantic Community, Atlantic Initiative, which is an internet-based think tank. On my left, I have Günter Nooke. He's a politician. He is a former civil rights activist. He was part of the democracy movement in former East Germany, which actually played a crucial role in contributing to the fall of the Berlin Wall in 1989. He's a member of the German parliament, and he's told me that he was a member of the German parliament, and he spent 6 months in this chamber, which used to be the former German parliament. He has been the Federal Commissioner of Human Rights and Humanitarian Aid, and currently he's the German Chancellor's Special Representative for Africa in the Ministry of Economic Cooperation and Development, which some of you would know from its German acronym, which is BMZ. Then it's my great pleasure to introduce His Excellency Lundeg Purevsuren, who is the Foreign Minister of Mongolia. Before he took this post, he was the advisor in national security and foreign policy to the President of Mongolia. He's had a wide range of diplomatic postings, including here in Bonn. You spent 5 years here, you told me. He also speaks fluent German. He spent time in countries like Wellington, in the US, and is very familiar with the challenges of foreign policy. And finally, Professor Franz-Josef Radermacher. He is a mathematician and an economist. He has PhDs in both, so in German he would be called Professor Doctor Doctor. He is now the director of the Institute for Applied Knowledge Processing in Ulm University. He is a founding member of the Global Marshall Plan, calling for global social order. He's also a member of the Club of Rome and a member of the German UNESCO Committee. Ladies and gentlemen, please give them a warm welcome. Now, Professor Radermacher, if I may start with you. You've said the effects of globalization is one of the biggest challenges facing the 21st century. Given that, do you think the fight for access to resources, natural resources, will be the defining element in the 21st century?
I think it will be an important element, but not necessarily the most important element. The reason is that while resources are very important, we always also have the chance by innovations to replace a needed resource by something else. 10,000 years ago, this world could only have 20 million people. They were collectors and hunters. They had no agriculture. This world can only feed 20 million people as collectors and hunters. And some people have romantic ideas about the situation 10,000 years ago. Yeah, we had no value-added tax. You need not to have a diploma. Yeah, you just could go around. But you could only have 20 million people. Today we have 7 billion, soon we have 10 billion. We had resource problems always, and we always had fights about resources, but we very often solved our problems with innovations. And I think that is the crucial issue. We have enormous pressure from not having enough resources given the many people we have and the technology we have. If we not get to new technologies, then we get really into trouble. But if we find, let's say, a new energy system that would not spoil the atmosphere, we have no climate catastrophe, then we can have a good situation even for 10 billion people. Innovation is at the center of a solution. If we have not the right innovations, then we really will be in trouble.
We'll talk about innovation in a bit, but let me turn now to His Excellency, Minister from Mongolia. Mr. Purevsuren, Mongolia is a very tiny country, but very rich in resources. Tiny in terms of population, not in terms of area. 1.5 million kilometers is, I think, the size of Mongolia, with 3 million people living in the country. Very rich in resources. Mongolia is sandwiched between two big countries, China and Russia. What challenges does this presence of resources have for you in terms of your foreign policy?
So you're right, Mongolia is very rich on the national resources, also only 3 million people and 1.5 million square kilometers territory we have. Of course, we have the very big history also, but especially last 25 years, we have a very vibrant and live democracy in Mongolia. And of course, the national mineral sources have some implications for the security and foreign policy of Mongolia. But I think the transparent and democratic society could manage that challenges. And otherwise, we know lessons from the other countries, which is very rich in the national resources, but they fail it to govern, to manage it. And therefore, the revenue management is very important, and governance and transparency is the main challenges, not only for the domestic policy, also for the foreign policy and security policy. And we should diversify the economy. We should export not only the raw materials, but we should also develop their own industry, diversify the economy, and also diversify the market. And of course, for the Mongolia, it's very challenging to balance between Russia and China, but the diplomats early 90s are genuine, that's to discover, develop the concept of the third neighbor. We would like to reach the third markets and the third countries with our products, and that way, we would like to also secure the independence, economic independence of the country, and then diversify the partners.
So you're talking about a third neighbor apart from Russia and China, third neighbor being a group of countries with whom you're also trying to establish close contact, and I think Germany is one of them, if that's right.
Yes, the Germany is the main main partner in Europe. We have also the resource. There are some agreements with the Germany, Rostov partnerships agreements. Mm-hmm. With the Germany, we are working quite close. But as the Mr. Radermacher said, also the future of the country is not the minerals. The future of the country is the education, is the people, and therefore it's also innovation. Therefore, we should invest the revenues of the resources and minerals to the people. And we are definitely the future of the country is the resource-based, not the resource-based economy, it's the knowledge-based economy, it's the education, it's the healthy people, it's the also, Mongolia has also not only mineral resources, but we have the very young, also well-educated young population. That's the future of the country.
It is one very interesting element there, what the minister is saying, Mr. Purevsuren, not just resources, natural resources, but human beings are also a resource for many countries. Very important point, and I'm sure we'll discuss this later, especially when the audience gets involved. Mr. Nooke, let me come to you now. We heard Minister Purevsuren talk about governance. You are very familiar with Africa. Many countries in Africa, very rich in resources, but very poor in governance. And this has often led to various conflicts, like, for example, in the Democratic Republic of Congo. How can one stop that?
That's difficult. But we can try to analyze the problems in the way where everyone is aware of his own responsibility. The companies, the government, the local society, and the NGO community, for instance. Let me start with an argument which sounds a little bit maybe very tough and from a perspective of a governmental official, but I think it's important to say that this resource wars, what we called, or what is the heading of the panel here, are very rare, historically speaking. There are but a few incidents of wars that were actually led because of resources. Usually, and that is the case in the Democratic Republic of the Congo, is the other way around. And that means conflicts exist already, and conflict parties use natural resources as one means amongst many others to finance themselves and to fuel the conflict. That's maybe the current issue on the ground also in African countries. And what we have observed in the Congo, in Eastern Congo, where everyone is familiar with the term of conflict minerals, we have observed this conflict over more than two decades among groups, and they all were interested in running a mine or have the power to control and to conduct the business on the mining side. And that is an issue where the German government, we supported those who want to clarify the supply chain, to certify the minerals in different mining sites. And on the other hand, we also very interested in a better governance. Mm-hmm. Also, we have a specific initiative among the G7, launched last year at a summit in Brussels, and renewed and with an additional code of conduct for those who are involved in mining. That means the government, the company, the advisors on both sides, so that we have an initiative where we also support weak governments in developing countries with independent advisors, so that that is one of the mixture of different things we can do.
For example, you did set up this initiative called the mineral certification scheme, because what I think a lot of us forget that not buying minerals from countries with poor governance is often affecting the people who are dependent on mining, the simple poor people, millions of people. And you have an initiative which is to certify the minerals got from fair and legal ways.
That's right. But again, to analyze the entire situation in Eastern Congo, even in Eastern Congo, we have to be aware that only one third is maybe of the mining sites and the minerals are controlled by rebel groups and those who are part of the conflict. The two thirds, the bigger part, is operated by state-owned or normal companies. So that we should be aware that there is not everything, even in Eastern Congo, is about conflict. So, and sure. Most of the money and the revenue for the national budget in the DRC comes from copper, cobalt, and other not this conflict minerals, tantal, tin, and tungsten. So mm-hmm. that the three T.
The three
so
Ts.
Maybe the debate is about how to get better deals, getting better deals, how to strengthen the government issues, the government side, and also to put pressure on the towards the companies that they have to operate in a way that it is responsible mining and not this kind of fooling conflicts.
You know, Jan, we'll be talking a lot about how companies can be more socially responsible in their dealings with resource-rich countries. But let me first ask you about the situation in Europe and European policy. Europe is also dependent on certain natural resources like gas and oil. And with the volatility in Russia, in the Middle East, what do you make of Europe's response in trying to secure natural resources?
Well, the energy and resource policy has very much moved up the agenda in the European Union and also in the national states. You're absolutely right. Europe is the biggest importer of energy. We spend 1 billion euro every day on energy imports, with a lot of dependency, particularly on gas, from Russia. And also, if you look at the German industry, for example, resources in manufacturing can make up to 45% of costs. So it's a very high priority also for the new EU Commission. And if you look at the strategy, you have the Energy Union, which is mostly dealing with reducing demand, energy efficiency, CO2 reduction, but also about diversifying supply. We can talk about this maybe a bit later, but looking to across the Mediterranean, to the Caspian Sea, but also looking to the United States in terms of supply for energy. And then also an important element is, I believe, playing a constructive role, as Mr. Nooke said, in specific countries, and their business plays a huge role, an important role, in terms of transparency, pushing certain rules and standards, etc., which is not always easy given that other more authoritarian states don't really play by that playbook.
So some of what you all are saying is that we need to optimize the use of our resources like energy, but there are certain resources, of course, which are finite, like water. But let me just stick with this idea of what role companies can play. Quite often, companies, big corporations, get involved in countries where there are weak leaders, but there's an abundance of minerals, gems, oil and gas, and set up contracts which, for the local people, can be quite exploitative.
Yeah, I mean, I think the traditional combination, maybe stemming particularly from the 70s and the 80s, was big multinationals moving into Latin America, moving into Africa, and particularly into mining, and that was not a particularly healthy relationship. Mm-hmm. And I think also from the Chinese side, if you look, their behavior in China is not always very positive for the local, or not positive at all for the local population. However, I think from the Western companies, there have been a lot of improvement over the 90s and the 2000s when it comes to transparency initiatives, when it comes to social responsibility on the ground, environmental friendly policies. And I think companies are not only doing this just to behave well and not to be blamed by non-profit organizations, but also in their own interest, because as corporate social responsibility plays a large role at home, it's today in today's world with social media all over and a lot of watchdogs initiatives, They're going to face a huge risk for the reputation for the brand if they don't do this. But also, if you look at employers, for example, young people in particular want to work for a company that is not exploiting some mines in Venezuela and paying $1 a day for a worker.
Professor Radermacher, let me come back to you. Before I talk to him, I want to after that ask you, Jakob, what is happening on social media. But Alpha, let me just first put a question to Professor Radermacher. We're all talking about optimizing resources, but you also raise a very important issue of innovation and technology in dealing with this competition for natural resources. Where do you think the focus should lie?
One point, as you say, is optimizing, or what in economics is called increasing the efficiency, mm-hmm. the resource efficiency, the energy efficiency, and so on. But of course, the much more important point is the innovation to replace one resource with another. Yeah, there is a nice wording that says, the Stone Age times didn't finish because of a lack of stones. Yeah, so we got rid of that by innovation 300 years ago. The limiting resource was forests. Wood was the limiting resources. And then eventually we found coal, and we replaced forests by coal and fossil fuels, and we overcame the energy crisis totally, and we had the industrial revolutions. Now we have a new problem, because that creates the climate problem. Mm-hmm. And suddenly the atmosphere is a resource we didn't think of. It is a sink for CO2. And the interesting thing about the atmosphere is it belongs to nobody. With most resources, it is that it belongs first to countries, and then under the country law, it belongs to somebody, maybe from another country. Essentially, rich people control the resources, and so the resources are very closely coupled with the ownership structure of the global economic system. But the climate is different because nobody owns the atmosphere. Mm. In any case, the essential issue is innovation, and the question is, do we find the right innovation in time? Mm-hmm. We have to feed 10 billion people in 2050. We must make it with the soils we have. We have to solve the climate problem. We have to have enough water for all people, and maybe these people want progress. Mm-hmm. And the question is, can we do it? I think, yes, we can do everything if we invent the right new energy system. If we not invent it, we will get really into trouble. But the innovation is at the core of everything.
A very good point, and we'll come back to that. And let me now ask Jakob, what are people saying on social media about resource wars and implications for foreign policy and security? Yeah.
Okay. Well, first, a small introduction. Social media users around the globe are still tweeting about yesterday's BOPS award ceremony, especially about the Freedom of Speech Award. The BOPS 15 hashtag was doing quite well yesterday, as well as Free Rife hashtag, but also our Global Media Forum hashtag DW_GMF. Thanks for using it so frequently. So far, we went through nearly 5,000 tweets in the last 3 days, which is quite amazing. There are so many interesting thoughts, comments, and questions. Jochen Spangberg tweeted, Global Media Forum is almost over, but the support for imprisoned journalists shouldn't be. Related to our last plenary session, Kyle Matthews hoped that our speakers are also going to talk about dwindling water supplies. Richard Stupat wrote, Mongolia as a resource-rich nation between Russia and China is like being a cake at the birthday party. Question coming from Kite Bolongaro. Sorry if I'm pronouncing your name wrongly. How can African countries solve the resource course? In Congo, deep warring factions use resources to fund their activities. Marie Lamench also has a question for our speakers. Can you mention and explain how ISIS makes money from resources?
Right, thank you very much, Jakob. Let me ask Minister Purevsuren about the role of government in resource wars. Now, you're in a country where lots of companies have invested, and they're not all Russian and Chinese. In fact, most of the companies involved in mining in Mongolia are Canadian and Australian. So what kind of regulations do you put on them to ensure that what they are doing is sustainable in terms of resource extraction?
So we have some lessons now during the last 10-15 years. So I would say the government, of course, playing a crucial role, but there are new players. You know, because IT and the information technologies, the people is now more knowledgeable and then also very informative. And therefore is the public opinion also is very important, also local communities, also green environmentalists is very important to listen to them. And therefore the Mongolian government is also pursuing policy to grant the inclusive growth for the country. 5 years ago, we were the world champions by the economic growth, 70.5%.
Wow.
But all the people was asking, what is the economic growth bringing for the ordinary people, ordinary Mongolian citizen? And that was most important, and therefore is we are trying to learn from our lessons. There was some lessons for Mongolia, and you know, we have today some symptoms of the Dutch diseases. And during the resource boom time, we have we granted a lot of the cash and then also social benefits for the people. And now there are also for citizens are demanding it. But in the now in the time of the slowdown of the world economic situation, also especially the commodity prices, we have some problems in the budget, and you should learn from that. And therefore, the most important issue is the transparency and the transparent governance, and also to keep the democratic rules in the country. Otherwise, you know, you're going to fail. You see resource-rich nations are succeeded. Mm. Is the democratic open societies. You see the Norway, you see the Australian, Canada. And where the government has failed to deliver inclusive growth and also lack of the transparency and then good governance, that was the failures of the nations. Therefore, Mongolia's it's very, very important, and we'd like to be a role model in the region to manage it, and then with the resources
to manage the resources and in the interest of the
to grant the inclusive growth and then also economic independence of the country.
Now that is, of course, Mr. Nooke, a big problem in Africa. Still, we heard that one Twitter question came on the Democratic Republic of Congo. But there are also signs of hope when we're finding new resources. Apparently, there have been potential oil fields found off the coast of East Africa. How does one ensure that when there are these resources or these potential finds, that they are used for the good of the people and not for the good of a few authoritarian regimes and maybe a few greedy companies?
Yeah, you mentioned the oil and gas resources offshore in the Indic Ocean for Mozambique and Tanzania in East Africa. And that are huge deposits of oil and gas. And of course, it starts with a good contract. Maybe before you can reach and achieve this, you have to manage the expectations. In Africa, we have a lot of expectations which are very unrealistic. The money under the surface in the deposit, 10 or 50 billion US dollar, that does not mean that you can get the money for the revenue or for the public interests. You have to find a company who is able to extract the resources or the minerals or the oil and gas in a way which is economically. And there's a lot of competition between sovereign states and presidents and or mining ministers in Africa, and this competition is a kind of gambling maybe, and on the much more stronger side, the international global mining or oil companies are in a very good position, and maybe we need a kind of more transparent and serious information about what's going on the ground, and not everyone has to try to get the best deal for their own interest. So I think this big resources will also force the states, the interacting states and the presidents, that they work together. And what we have observed in the issue of limited water resources, maybe to use this in a way for renewable energy.
Energy, yeah.
That could be also a trigger, and the interacting states have been, or they have to cooperate with the state who is maybe able to build the dam, and then the other depends from the state,
which is
in a higher altitude. So that's very interesting. That also this kind of water resources have been triggered the situation that. Yeah, water resources could make peace and not war. Cooperation is a very, very important thing, also in the oil and gas issue.
So you're suggesting that actually, instead of in countries with water stress, you can actually use the conflict to promote cooperation, because water, of course, is a huge issue. River systems all over Africa, be it the Nile in Jordan or in Asia, the Indus.
The wars regarding water hasn't not take place. But in the 1990s, it was promised, and it hasn't happened.
Jan, let me come to you on this. From what Mr. Nooke is saying, obviously, when companies get involved in countries. To get access to resources. What he's trying to say is fundamentally you have to have good contracts, you have to have good legal basis, you have to have good corporate social responsibility. Is that happening?
I think it is, increasingly so. We have numerous examples. You have the big oil and gas companies, BP and Shell, leading the way after they learned their hard lesson. If you look at what BAP, Billiton, and Rio Tinto, for example, the big mining companies have been set up as social responsibility programs within the countries. That is very significant. You have the former founder of Transparency International, Peter Eigen, has started the Extractive Industry Transparency Initiative, IT, where a lot of basically every major player is a member of, you can't afford not to be a member of, which calls for more transparency in the regions, including tax benefits, et cetera, making sure that briberies are not happening, et cetera. On the other hand, you do still have cases like some mining instances in Latin America, South America, for example, where you still have huge complaints by the indigenous population. That has been several times in the press over the last couple of weeks as well. So it's not all great. And I think an important component is that everybody has to play by the same rules. And Chinese, for example, state-owned enterprises do not necessarily play by the same compliance rules. And then, of course, you're facing a problem because then you are on a disadvantage towards these companies who just don't really care, sign up some contracts, maybe pay a bit more money, but are not really interested in social responsibility. That is changing as well. A lot of people from Africa telling at least the European Union, look, the Africans are getting tired a bit of these kind of procedures. But it's a bit of a competition between the West trying to do good, and the rest of the world maybe not trying not to do great.
But Professor Radermacher, if I may come to you, what we want to talk about basically is that, you know, it's not just a question of some countries having all the resources, there are other countries which have less resources. You talked about China. China is very rich in minerals which are really important for us in the modern world, which is the rare earth minerals. China has 95% of that, and yet China has a big population to feed, and they are trying to look for land outside of China. That is, they are buying land in New Zealand, they are buying land in Australia, they are buying land, large tracts of land in Africa. And so The question is, Jan was talking about that we all must play by the same rules. How optimistic are you, Professor Radermacher, that governments are playing by the same rules? Or is it a question, as always, that the rich and powerful countries are able to manipulate the countries which are poor but rich in resources to get access to their natural resources?
I would say that essentially we play by the same rules, but it is not the rules we need. Mm-hmm. Yeah, we have the WTO, we have the IWF, we have a lot of in finance, in trade, and these are strong systems, powerful. And then we have the system for everything that is nice to have, like social, cultural environment, that is the United Nations, and it has no power. And there is deliberately an organization where the power is with the economy and with the financial system, and where the United Nations is only soft law. This is deliberate. And as a result, powerful interests are able to have the system work as they want it to work. Mm. Now, the difference here is not between rich countries and poor countries. No, it is between, let's say, the 1 or 2% that globally control the assets and the rest. And this, let's say, powerful resource and money-rich groups sit everywhere. They sit in poor countries as they sit in rich countries, and they see it all from a business perspective and their property rights. The issue of distribution, of social balance, is a different topic. What I'm very happy for is that since the financial crisis, we have a certain shift in the global debate. Up to that time, we had a market fundamentalistic position in economics that the market would do it and the governments should keep out. Since 2007, 2008, the debate is about green and inclusive markets. This is now the position of the OECD. We go for green and inclusive markets. It's also position of IWF and World Bank of the United Nations anyhow. Suddenly, we go against tax havens. Suddenly, we go against aggressive tax minimization. Suddenly, we have a debate that markets need an ordo-liberal framework of constraints concerning environment and concerning social balance, and that we need transparency about that. And this is, I think, a chance to change the world. So the issue is better global governance rules. It is not that we don't have the rules, we have the wrong rules.
Great, so now that's a very interesting comment. Do you share that view, Minister? That we have good institutions, good rules, but they're not the rules for us to face the future for a country like yours?
Yes, of course, there should be legal basis, the better legal basis to distribute and the resources. And of course, the resources, the minerals or resources should be accessible for the whole world, where it's found, but you know, Mongolia is sandwiched between two giants. We have some resources, but the other nations, they don't have it. For example, Germany, we could deliver it. That it should be, but legal basis is accessibility rules that generally also accepted. That's, I think, the main things now, international relations. Yeah.
Response to Mr. Rademacher. I think that's very important to have the right global rules. But on the other hand, I have traveled a lot through African countries, and we have sovereignty for every state, and they are owning the minerals or the oil and gas deposits, and they are very self-confident. And so we sometimes as politicians, we have to avoid the worst and not to speak about in a philosophical way about the global governance issues. And so I think that why I started with the contracts and expectation management, we have to inform seriously. We have to say that the German interest, for instance, is also very clear in the time being. Mm-hmm. We are an export-oriented economy or industry here in the Federal Republic of Germany, and we need commodities, minerals, all this natural resources at the world market, free traded. That's the best way for us. So the Germans, that was maybe not very, very, very helpful, but they sold their big mining companies in the 1970s and 1980s already, and now there is no global mining company owned by Germans, and we are much more in the situation where we can give some advice. We are an old mining nation, the oldest mining academy in Saxony, in Freiburg, in the world is in Germany, and so we are more the honest, an honest broker between different interests. But in the end, that is maybe not in line with the Club of Rome, but we want to get that the resources and the minerals were extracted, and that the more traded at the world market, the better for the German economy. So that is sometimes very similar to the interests of African countries or those who are resource-rich countries. But we have to do this in a better way. And what you mentioned regarding Peter Eigen, the founder of Transparency International and EITI, what we are doing in the time being together with him is to speak about getting better contracts. It's not the best way to have a perfect monitoring of bad contracts in the EITI and the financial flows. It's better you will get a contract which is fair to both sides, and also for the company, the predictability and the accountability of the government and the company, and the fair sharing of the benefits and the risks of such a contract. You have to be aware of mining is a big business. $1 or $5 billion US dollar have to be invested in an area where you do not know what the next president will do in the country, and so it's a lot of sophisticated work in detail work, and not to speak too much in a general way.
That's right. So you're looking at specifics, because after all, it's just not minerals we're talking about. We're talking about water, we're talking about timber, we're talking about rainforests, we're talking about land. And as you said, that some countries are rich in some resources, but they're looking for other resources. As I said, China's looking for land, but so are the Gulf countries. Rich in oil, but again, looking for land in Africa. And we have lots of participants here from Africa and different countries within Africa. Maybe you'd like to share your views soon. But let me just ask a final question to you, Jan. Professor Radermacher said we need to change the way we are doing things, that the fundamental rules in access to resources have to change. Is that a view that you, your company, shares when you give advice for public policy?
Yeah, I'm a big fan of the Club of Rome and a good global governance framework. And I think it's not contradictory to companies' interests and, if you want, national interest, if you say the European Union has a national interest. Because if you look at the strategy of, for example, reducing energy or increasing energy efficiency, where you have, I think, 40% of EU energy goes into buildings, industry eats up 25%. If we invent better building quality, if we invent better transport and better industries, that is also something that we can export to the world. And this green and clean technologies will help other countries as well. So I don't think necessarily that because we try to reduce our dependency on other countries, we're selfish necessarily. Of course, it's an interest of both industry and the government to reduce that, but we invest billions in technology and R&D. We also encourage business to do so. And I think that is also an attractive expert model. And on the company side, I think those companies that understand well, and the big multinational players do understand very well, that they have to engage on a global stage. If you look at the statistics in the indices, social responsibility investments, etc., they're taking that very seriously. And also, final point is, international pension funds, for example, the big Californian pension funds or the Norway oil fund, are now divesting from companies that are not paying enough attention to decarbonization. They're divesting from companies very actively in behaving badly in countries like Africa. So this is there's also a lot of healthy pressure from big institutional shareholders. And who are the owners of these funds? These are pensioners around the world who give and trust their money to certain funds. And these fund managers, who are the capitalists per se, because they need interest and they need a good yield to be able to pay the pensions, they insert pressure, or they put pressure on larger companies. I think that is an increasingly interesting trend, had been a trend already before the financial crisis, then broke up a bit 2008, it's now coming back again on the agenda.
Thank you, Jan. That was an interesting comment, an interesting perspective on how one can positively deal with some of the challenges which are facing us. Now, I would invite Jakob to tell us what's happening on social media, and then I'll invite questions from the floor. Jakob, what are people saying?
Remark posted by African diaspora, resource wars, implications for foreign and security policy, but no one panelist from the continents with the biggest resources, when we will stop talking about and start talking with Africa. Hannah Wallace Broman asks, panel focuses innovation equals solution, but what about addressing unsustainable economic systems underpinning exploitation of resources? Another question posted with the hashtag DW_GMF, why is China the bad guy and the West good? Canadian and Australian companies behave the same way as China in other countries. Andrea Cuotas say at least the word tax was now mentioned. Global governance means stronger and other rules. Giri wrote, what if companies own essential resources? The reason of resources conflict is just the misdistribution, isn't it? Silvana Suma also addressed a question to our speakers. What about information and communications technology for the sustainable use of natural resources?
Thank you very much, Jakob. There are a whole host of questions here, and a lot of them to do with good governance and also about value judgments. Why is what China does is wrong, but if a Western nation does that, it's not wrong. Also about sustainability, and also why are we talking about Africa and not with Africa? This is now your chance for people who come from the continent of Africa, if you want to raise questions. I have a gentleman in the hat there, and I have this gentleman and three. Can we take microphones to the gentleman in the hat there, then the person in the blue sweatshirt, and then the person with the printed shirt?
Thank you so much. My name is Faustin Pitanyanda. I'm from Tanzania. And I want to add some input on the debate. I would just go straight forward to the matter about migration and about the resources. I think it's the matter of African people or African governments to have proper people who are able to negotiate contract. Because the nature of business is closing contract. So if you have poor people who cannot negotiate properly, or people who are not having the will to support the continent, then you run into problems. Then I will give you an example. There are so many countries around the world that don't have natural resources. I live in Switzerland. That country, it doesn't have anything. I mean, it's having mountains. But Switzerland is investing in ideas. That is the resource of that country. So we will have so many diamonds, gold, elephants, which you cannot even put them in a balance sheet. Again, if you don't have the knowledge to transform this natural resource into cash, you have a big problem. So it's a challenge for young people in Africa that what do we do for our government? Because we don't have to complain. Government is for people, by the people of the people.
Thank you.
So, I want to finish up 1 second. So, we have to have innovative idea. And there is no way that African people have failed to determine it themselves. And there is no way to escape this truth until we commit, we come together, we work together with the enthusiasm of transporting this content to the point that we want. Again, in case of the European multinational corporations or company, or the Asian company which are operating in Africa, there are so many suffering. You have also to ask yourself, are you there to exploit? You have to help. You go there with your company, you negotiate, and you really want to give those people 0.5% and you take 95%. I mean, we are living in a one world. I'm not worried about China to buy land somewhere, because sometimes maybe they want to have more than one kid. So somebody wants to move out of China. Because this is our world. You can live anywhere you want, but as long as you follow the regulations and all the protocol which is put in place. So my recommendation is for the young people, the government, and even the European people to come together, sharing understanding and the idea. This is what we want. We want to make business. So the European young people make business with African. That is fair.
So let's
the
get
thing
another
is,
African
what
voice
do you
there.
Bring to Africa? And the Africa should be able to choose the people they want, which kind of investor you want within your country.
Should we ask another
so
African voice? Let's ask another African voice there. Thank you very much for that comment.
Thank you very much as well. I'm Andre Tafak. I will define myself as a media observer from Cameroon. For an African in this kind of session, it's very difficult to speak without much passion, because you touch, you put your finger on where it's bleeding, where it's hurting most when you talk about resource wars in Africa. And Amrita summarized the whole thing very well when she mentioned the three actors: authoritarian regimes, greedy companies, and then during the discussion, the currently biggest sinner, as I would call it, has also been mentioned, but on the sideline, it's China. It's an open secret that the resources of Africa have been bleeding for more than 6 centuries, starting with the human resources, which bleeded for 4 centuries during the slave trade, and then were taken over by the exploitation from Western countries during the colonial times, which ended, theoretically ended in the middle of the 20th century. And then, for a time, they left the African as independent country, even though they still pulled the things from the background and determined where the resources will go. And now we find ourselves in a situation which is summarized in Cameroonian media as a kind of third abandonment of Africa to greedy China. If you take a look at all the exploitation contracts that we have in most African countries today, you realize that China holds the lion's share now in most African countries. And the European company, though they have some kind of remorses about what they have done throughout those centuries, are saying, okay, there are those global rules, and the professor told us what those rules are actually. But my main concern, and that's what I want to put to the panel, is is the world letting Africa down to those greedy three authoritarian regimes, greedy companies, and China? Throwing the Western, the European Union and Western nation now throwing the towel in front of China in the current context of resources in Africa, with the security consequence that we are seeing. I will just mention two levels: Boko Haram, disenfranchised youth who have no access to the resources, and migration, the youth who have no opportunity. due to very, very bad educational opportunities, no employment opportunities, and seeing the only opportunities as trying to find a way to get to Europe no matter how, and also putting a strain on the social security systems of Europe. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that, and the gentleman here in the printed shirt.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Caleb Fagade from Nigeria, presently in Center for European Integration Study here in Bonn. There is, according to what the professor said, that there is form of double standard that the rich are the one determining how the rule will operate. My question is, how do we change this particular challenge in the world? Because there is one example I want to cite now. Like, we are discussing resources now, but we don't talk about agriculture. Where much of these resources that we are talking about actually lies. But I discovered that when it is convenient, you look the other way. But when it is not convenient, you look at that particular issue. EU-like competition, for example, on industries, they want competition across the world. But on agriculture, no. Because like common agriculture policy has been distorting global competition based on huge subsidy on all this material. But people don't talk about it because it is convenient for Europe to subsidize agriculture. But because energy is quite different, we talk about energy, we talk about those things that are like giving each society problem. But the one that is convenient, you don't talk about that. You are not interested in talking about that because there have been a lot of issues since 1960-something that common agriculture policy started, how it is distorting competitiveness of other countries of the world. Till date, no solution in that regard.
Right.
So how can we change the standard?
Thank you very much for that contribution. So we've had now three voices from Africa. We've had someone from Tanzania, from Cameroon, and from Nigeria. And from what I can see underlying the whole discussion is that at some level, the question they're asking, has the world let down Africa? Is the world turning away and only doing business which suits it? And it's not looking at the interests of Africans in Africa. Let me take the specific question, Professor Radermacher. We had one gentleman say that the world is letting down Africa. An example of China was given. China, of course, is investing in agriculture. Many people feel that investing in agriculture in Africa is a good thing. Other people see it as land grabbing. Now, in your view, do you think the world is letting down Africa in terms of this resource war?
I think there is first a big problem in talking about, let's say, Africa versus Europe. Mm. Because in a sense, then you say, there is Africa talking with one voice. But Africa is many states, many companies, many elites, and they all have their own interests. And it's the same with Europe. It's many countries, many companies, many elites, they all have their interests. And there is China and India, and of course, having their interest. And they play the game under the rules we have. And I think under those rules, it is a big progress that China came out of poverty and developed into a power, which is progress for 1.4 billion people, which is three times Europe. Now this China is a new actor. It has power and it plays the games as good as it can. And it goes to Africa. Okay, I think in a sense for Africa it's not bad to have a second actor, not only the West, but China. So there's a certain chance to play with two guys instead of only having the Europeans and the West who always were looking for their advantage. Now there is a chance for China to play with two guys, and maybe that can help to improve the situation in Africa. Essentially, Africa has to help itself. It has to develop economic power. And to the degree it develops power, it can have better contracts. As long as the African countries, the African people are economically comparatively weak, they will not get reasonable contracts. Only if we come to different solutions on the world level. I think we urgently have to come to global minimal standards. We need global minimal daily allowances. We need to pay globally for the protection of rainforests. We have to pay globally for, let's say, diversity biologically. So in a sense, we would have to price the use of global commons to make global social and ecological policy. But we are not yet at that point. But if we want to have a reasonable future, we have to get there. Then by this mechanism, there would be a money flow from rich parts of the world to poorer parts, and there would be individually daily allowances, so nobody would have to have hunger or real poverty, because there is a global responsibility to care for social minima. But this is not where we are. This is where we have to come. And we have to solve it on that level and not between China and Kenya.
A very good point here. I just want to bring in one little point here because we're running out of time. If I may quickly ask you, Minister, because the concept, the idea of contracts, having the right contracts has come up with one of the gentlemen there and also here. It's really important to have the right contracts, and weaker countries sometimes don't have the know-how to negotiate with powerful. Now, you are a country which is small in terms of population, and you are doing these contracts with these big fat countries around you. What is the key to getting the right advice on getting the right contracts? Briefly, if you can tell me.
So really, we have some lessons, Mongolia, on the way to the democracy in the last 25 years. We have also dealt with some new actors, you know, the global commodity companies. You know, the Rio Tinto invested in Mongolia in one project, $5-6 billion. Of course, Rio Tinto is the world class company, and they have for centuries dealt with subcontracts. From other side, we have the young ministers sitting and then learning by doing. There was some lessons for us. Of course, as the from our auditorium, the colleagues from Tanzania saying this capacity building, national capacity building is most important, and therefore is, I think government should invest in the education, in invest in the people, and then you could have also good contracts, and then also Mongolia is sharing our experiences with other nations, and then we are contributing to the South-South dialogue. We created within the Ministry of Foreign Affairs the Mongolian International Cooperation Fund, and we allocated some money, and we are training the people and the government people, the public officials, also journalists, also NGO people from Kyrgyzstan, from Myanmar, and then sharing our experiences. Of course, we are saying we have nothing to teach to the others, but we have something to share.
Brilliant. Now that is, we're running out of time. There is always a tyranny of time. That's the tyranny I'm under right now. So what I'm going to suggest is I'll take another round of your questions. The gentleman there with a jacket, and then there's a lady in a green. We'll start with the lady in the green sweater. And one more question. And a gentleman at the back there in a what looks like a brown shirt from me. And Dr. We listen to these things, and then maybe you could respond to them. Because, and if I may, and this, okay. A final question, then gentlemen in if you just stand up so they can see you. So we'll begin with the lady and then we'll go around. Okay, yeah, we'll begin with the lady. And if I may request, and I'm sorry to do this, but because we're running out of time, if you can keep your comments and questions short. Thank you.
Hello? Yeah. Hi, my name is Nadine Gerard. I'm not from Latin America, but I've lived and worked there for a long time, and I'm hoping that maybe I can ask a question about this other continent that has problems with resources. I have two questions, comments. First of all, you were saying that these companies are now having better standards, that they can't afford to be socially not responsible anymore, and that you were saying that the atmosphere is free and we have to work with innovation, but you have areas in Mexico, for example, where wind parks are being put up to make use of the air, and in order to do this, German companies as well take land from indigenous populations, and no one is asking the indigenous populations, also always with the deal of the national governments or the regional governments, they have no interest in protecting those people. But I think there's still quite a lot to be done. And the picture might obviously be better than it was in the 80s or 90s, but I think there's still a long way to go. My other comment builds a bit on one of the Twitter comments that was there before, how non-state actors, who you can't have contracts with mm-hmm. or get to and negotiate, use these natural resources to fund their wars, whether this is ISIS or whether these are Mexican drug cartels that use timber and ship them off to China. I think that's quite another area that we haven't touched on here, and I would hope, now relating to foreign policy, that German foreign policy or in their trade negotiations or in their foreign policy negotiations with those countries also make a point about that and look at that when they talk to these countries.
Thank you. The gentleman in the gray jacket, yes.
Thank you. Bill Clifford of the World Affairs Councils of America, a nonprofit in D.C. My question is not about rich-poor divide, but rather a competition pitting rich countries against each other, and where the climate predicament has opened up this possibility in the Arctic, which holds up to about a quarter of the world's undiscovered natural gas and oil reserves. Big countries are not responding to innovation, and multilateral governance seems to be behind the curve. This is a classic scramble for territory, territorial claims, sovereignty issues. How does the rest of the world respond to this?
Thank you. There was a gentleman there at first, the one with the beard, yes.
Thank you. Thank you for giving me opportunities to share my opinion, and especially thank you to Amrita. It is a great and a great talk and a great discussions over that. And I totally agree that innovative we need in our future and our future for the human being. But innovation just not solve the problem. We need sharing. Mm-hmm. When we talk about the resource problems and then also our own problem in our especially in the poor country, the developing countries, and the governance problems, and now people talk about the education. And hey, you need education to solve this problem. But education is the business. You need money. There are millions of people without education. Then the vicious cycle goes on. I really request the developed country and the rich countries and the multinational companies to share.
We need sharing. A final comment now from the gentleman with the beard, yes.
My name is Richard Stewpart. I'm a fellow at the African Good Governance Network. I'm from South Africa. My question to the panel is to ask, how do you think we can build pressure to end the abuse of transfer pricing as a way of wealth extraction from African countries, but not just African countries? The examples here are maybe Lonmin, Glencore, others that extract more money from Africa, among others, than many times more money than is extended to the continent in official development assistance. And often the answer to this gets kicked down to, well, it's the job of governments to stand up against groups like Lonmin. But the example of the Zambian government and elsewhere in the continent has shown that many poorer country governments are not in a position to prevent the plundering of resource value by companies that abuse transfer pricing. So where do you see the pressure coming from for reform of that abuse?
Thank you very much. Now, I'm in this uncomfortable situation that our time has run out, and I don't want to encroach into your coffee break. But if you allow me, and with your permission, can I ask all the panelists to give us a one-minute wrap and touch on any of these very big issues that you've raised, the question of transfer pricing, the question of non-state actors, the question of rich within the rich scrambling for resources. Is that okay with you? If you all say, those who are not for it, raise your hands. Okay, thank you very much then. So I'm going to start with Jan, with you, a one-minute wrap, please. Any question that is of importance, but you all have just 1 minute. Thank
okay,
you.
Okay, I take on two questions. The one with financing terrorist groups, ISIS, drug lords from Mexico. This is becoming an increasing concern, and people are much aware of this. And that might sound unpleasant, but for that, we definitely need intelligence service to work on this with us, because that's part of their job. And the second is on Africa, and if you let them down, I share all the concerns. But on the positive note, there's no single big institution investor conference in the world, be it large private equity funds or be it large pension fund, where the first slide is not the 10 countries with most growth potential in the world. Africa, 8 of 10 are African, and they're not seen as a resource country of resources, but as big, huge growth markets, telecoms, infrastructure, transport, energy. So there's a lot of attention in Africa, and the CEO of Turkish Airlines just recently said, Africa is a new China, and that's my final comment.
Mr. Nooke, 1 minute. And I'm timing
I,
you.
I would like to answer a little bit more about the different questions, but let me start with the hesitations and the concerns of the African colleagues here. Of course, many things went wrong on the continent, but on the other hand, even every deal with the Chinese, you need the political will to get a better deal. That's the first thing. If there is no political will at the governmental level, or also among the local authorities, and corruption is endemic in many areas in Africa, then you can't support those people. It's not the business of the Europeans to avoid Chinese investments in Africa. But what we can say is what I tried to explain in my words before, that we want to give independent support to those governments who have who want to get better deals and to have this independent advisors, and not only law firms from the East Coast in the United States working mostly for the private companies. So that was the idea of the G7 initiative Connex, that this kind of support really will provide it in a way that could be used. So that's very sophisticated in detail. And I would only about capacity building. We have a lot of we have had a lot of capacity building in African countries. But in the end, I can understand everyone, every man and woman who is moving from the governmental or state side to the private companies, paying 10 times more for their knowledge and education they have earned, also by donor countries and in the by the countries. And so we need this capacity building also on the job, training on the job when the contracts will be negotiated. That is one thing of this initiative. And I would agree with Mr. Radermacher, not speaking too much about Africa. There is an old mining nation, South Africa, and it's in the same way as Europeans or United States, Canadians, Australians, or Chinese and Indian companies. I think the best way is to have this strengthening of the negotiation capacity on the governmental side of those countries who want to use their natural resources for development in a responsible way. That's a main issue for me. And then I would like to to respond to the transfer pricing. That's really an issue. The last UK presidency raised this issue. It's also among the G7. We are knowing this, and we want to put pressure on those companies. But that's also linked for me to better contracts. You also can negotiate, for instance, ad valorem royalties, and not too much put into the taxation framework, whereas no one who is able to guarantee independent courts and judiciaries, the legal system is fine. In many African countries, the mining laws are much better than in Germany. But no one is interested that the companies and everyone is operating in line with those legal framework.
We need
some other instruments for the current situation. It's okay, I can speak a lot about this, but of course we have the coffee break.
I know, I'm so sorry about that. It's really, may I ask you, Minister, what are your final comments in response to anything that you've heard here?
So of course we are all interested in sustainable development, so sustainable contracts. I think it's still duty of the government to reach the sustainable contracts, and then also to reach the consensus. I think to listen to the local community, to the voices of the environmental groups, also to the voices of the investors, and then therefore I think is now the time to come the new mentality to the resource businesses. I think because the IT technology, as I said, the people is very knowledgeable, and a lot of new players are there. And also, according also to that, also very high expectations. So government and also investors should manage the expectations. That's also important. And then you're going to reach the consensus, and then we could allow a very sustainable contracts and sustainable developments. So all also includes the education, also how to finance the education, how to manage, how to also spend the revenues from the mining sectors, and also how to deal with the investors' interest, also local interest, also environment. I think the role of the government is still very high, but for the investor side, it should be some new mentality, and according to the new technologies also, and to have the sustainable businesses and managements there.
Thank you very much. And one 30-second final comment from you. 30 seconds now, Professor Radermacher.
Yes.
A final comment to leave us, to end the session.
I tried to be short with 3 points.
3 points? You can't be short. Then 10 seconds
short.
Per point.
one person said, the old power struggle is back. Countries are fighting for territory and resources in the Arctic or on the sea level. Yes, it's old type politics. It's only a few guys, very powerful. They hate that the others take it away and they want it for themselves. Big issue. Could
point
lead
one.
To war.
Mm-hmm.
Second point is, yes, we now go to Alaska, we go to the Arctic to have more gas, while at the same time at the G7, we decided decarbonization by the end of the century. So the stuff has to stay in the ground, but while we all talk about leaving it in the ground, we are exploring new sites. The big issue will be to compensate the ownership rights of people having the deposit for leaving it in the ground. That will be the real issue. And the third point is, we have to do an operation on a living body. We are 7.5 billion people. We soon 10 billion people. We have assets, $400,000 billion. If this system doesn't run, hundreds of millions of people will die, have no food, no water. So we have to keep this enormous complex system running while we have to change it.
That is a very huge challenge and is absolutely not clear that we will smoothly do it.
Thank you very much, Professor Radermacher. Now, I want to thank all of you very much for being here because, and for your patience and for the great interest with which you've listened. I want to thank Jakob for bringing us the Twitter comments to us. The thing that I take from all of you is that that is a very profound and very inspirational for me. We need to share, we need to work together. This enough for everybody. We need to bring it all together. I'm reminded of a comment made by Mahatma Gandhi. He said, there's enough for the need of everyone in this world, but not enough for the greed of everyone in this world. And I think this debate has symbolized that. Let me thank the panelists. Please give them a warm hand. And thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Amrita. Thank you, everyone. I'm just going to tell you we have a coffee break coming up now. Directly after that, it'll be followed by our breakout sessions and our workshops, rather. And immediately after that, just around 1 o'clock, just after 1 o'clock, we'll reassemble here for our closing ceremony featuring Scylla Elworthy as our keynote speaker. Thank you very much. By the way, if you have your headsets, just please leave them in the room or drop them at the desk on your way out the door. Thank you.